Hello, welcome to this week's Dividend Cafe. I'm recording here from the Newport office, but by the time you're listening to this, I'm going to be out in the New York office where we do our annual due diligence trip, and both Dea Pernas from my team and myself are headed for about 20-plus meetings with portfolio managers and asset partners in New York City. And also, by the time you're listening to this, the third quarter of 2017 will have come to a wrap. We're still a couple days away here, but basically wrapping up the third quarter, all indications are that September looks to be a positive month in equities, and the third quarter looks to be a positive month across capital markets. International developed not so much, but still modestly positive, but emerging markets very strong, U.S. equities, positive movement. Fixed income, positive movement, although interest rates have moved up a bit this month, and so forth. So strong month, strong quarter in the midst of what has obviously been thus far a strong year. We're going to have a lot more to say when we get back from New York. I really want to devote the bulk of my time here in this week's Dividend Cafe video to the tax plan that was released today by the Trump administration in concert with the House and Senate leadership. There's still a lot of work to be done, but since all we've really had is a one-pager since I believe April, and I could be wrong on that, but it's been at least 4 or 5 months, and today we got a nine-pager. And so 9 pages of details is not a law. It's not a piece of legislation, which will inevitably end up being over 1,000 pages. But there's a little bit more meat on the bone, so to speak, than we've had. And I want to comment on a few things. They want to bring 7 different individual tax rates down to 3, the low rate being 12%, the middle rate being 25%, and then the top rate being 35%, which is currently 39.6. So some flattening and reductions of marginal individual rates and an incredible amount of simplicity relative to the current structure. But 2 things need to be said. A, the legislation calls for congressional discretion to add a 4th rate at the very high level. So they could very well come back with some sort of 40% rate for people over 5 million income or something like that. It may be more populist and political. Don't ask me what I happen to think about that. But they left the door open for that, a little odd. But more importantly, they didn't release the details on where those income levels would be that define the 3 brackets. And so we don't necessarily know exactly how much less different taxpayers at different marginal rates would be paying, because we don't know where the income thresholds are going to be for those 3 rates. You would think that's kind of important information. It is very wise for them politically to not release it yet and invite all kinds of scrutiny and criticism and back and forth. So they're kind of sandbagging on that, and I'm quite sure it's politically on purpose. But the other piece then is that they are doubling the standard deduction, 12,000 individual, 24,000 married couple, and then substantially increasing, again, without specificity, the child tax credit. So what it would sound to me is that like a $50,000 income household would be probably paying no taxes at all, and maybe a $70,000 income family would be paying very small taxes. So they're going to try to sell it on that level and counteract criticism that it is a tax plan benefiting the wealthy. Politics are politics, but I mean, it, just as the fact of the matter is, I suspect an awful lot of high income taxpayers will end up paying more under this, largely because they're eliminating a high amount of the deductions. Most importantly, the deduction for state and local income taxes, it appears, is being taken away. As a matter of policy, I happen to really advocate that, because really what happens is the high state income tax states, by the federal government allowing that to be deductible, it just becomes a subsidy that low income tax states are paying for the high income tax states. But regardless of what anyone believes about it, for good or for bad, they essentially said that they're getting rid of these income deductions, and the ones they're keeping are charitable unlimited, well, within the income limits already exist, and then the mortgage interest deduction, which was going to be a political hot button. So by not including in that list of charitable and mortgage, the state and local were left to assume that their prior rhetoric about eliminating that deduction is indeed going through. In terms of the corporate tax rate, which is more significant for us as investors, they did come out with a 20% corporate tax rate, essentially what I've been sort of forecasting all year. Understood the need to say it would be at 15, didn't really see a path to getting that done, but also glad that they were not content to leave it at a 25 level, which would have been a little bit easier to do, but not nearly as stimulative. As far as other pieces to corporate tax legislation, they are allowing for full expensing of business expenditures and capital investment, business investment, but for 5 years, not in perpetuity, and then giving lawmakers the discretion to extend that later. So again, wise politically, but a little different than what may be expected. Not a lot of clarity yet on what they're going to do with interest expense deduction for corporations. I think there's a couple things to be said here. I would be in favor of them limiting and qualifying and so forth where interest expense to take on debt would be deductible for businesses. But I also think that that's an area in which they believe they can maybe limit some of the excessive credit buildup in the system by making it less tax favorable. So that clarity isn't totally there. Repatriation, they want to charge a one-time tax. They did not say what the rate would be. Bring foreign profits back on shore. We believe there's $2.5 trillion offshore, $2 trillion of which would come back to the United States with some form of repatriation. Let's see here. In terms of other highlights that are pertinent to investors from the tax plan, I do think that there is a lot to be said about the elimination of alternative minimum tax for higher earners. I don't think that they're going to have any problem getting that through. It's a very complex and silly tax. Then they are saying in this tax bill they're getting rid of the death tax or estate tax. I'm very skeptical politically that they'll end up going through with that. I happen to believe they should, but I don't think that they will for a number of political reasons. I suspect that's going to come back in the process, but we'll see how that goes. From the vantage point of investors, the big takeaways are that they did show a lot of thoughtfulness in the plan and sensitivity to the political realities, which would indicate to the market a likelihood that they have a path to getting this done. The main issue here you need to understand is that they have to show the Freedom Caucus in the House that they have a viable plan that is going to be reasonably palatable to them so that they'll vote for a budget in October. If they don't have a budget, they can't attach this to reconciliation. Therefore, they can't get it done with 51 votes or 50 votes plus Vice President Pence. If they have to go down the 60-vote path, it's not going to get done. And yet, there's some people who won't vote for a budget unless they see terms in this that they like. So that's kind of the chicken or egg here going on, and I don't think I've talked enough about that political reality. As far as pass-through entities go, for small business owners, LLCs, limited partnerships, S-corporations, they're talking about a 25% rate, so they won't come all the way down to the 20% rate they're offering to C-corporations, but they're not going to leave them at the personal income rates, which are often 35 to 40% for these family-owned type businesses. So very, very pro-growth. However, they said for certain pass-through entities and did not qualify what that means. And there's been talk before that they may do it for manufacturing businesses and not other businesses. That to me is a really unfortunate development if it is true. First of all, I think it lends itself to incredible crony capitalism, but also will leave the market not knowing exactly where that stimulative benefit might come from. So that's the basic highlights. I'm open to any questions you may have. If you want to email us, I'd love to interact with this more. We're still kind of digesting it, but more market sensitivity around the viability than the actual details. The details themselves are mostly in line with what we expected. Little more clarity on the rates. Some were believing that he may leave the top rate at 39.6. We now saw 35. That 12% bottom rate coupled with a doubling of the standard deduction should pacify the class warfare argument that it's more of a benefit to the rich than the lower income payers. I understand there's going to be a lot of different political assessments of it, but from a market viewpoint, which is what you're listening to this for, we think it's favorable to the market. And what the market now has to discern is whether or not they're going to get it done. But a repatriation, a territorial system, expensing a business investment, and a lower corporate tax rate, this is very pro-growth, it's very supply side, and that's the scoop. I'm going to leave it there because if I go into all the other subjects going on, then I'll really bore you to pieces. But that's our tax summary and comments. Reach out with questions. Then I'm going to be recording Dividend Cafe next week from New York City. Thank you very much for listening, Dividend Cafe.